Matthew chapter 14, continuing in the study of Follow Me. Today we're following Follow Me Increasing. Follow Me Increasing. Dear God, be with us now. Pray, God, you'd anoint your word to do according to your will. Lord, make my mind clear. Use me to preach to these people what you want them to hear. In Jesus' name, amen. Matthew chapter 14, we'll begin in verse 1. The Bible says, at that time Herod, the tetrarch, heard of the fame of Jesus, and said unto his servants, this is John the Baptist. He is risen from the dead, and therefore mighty works do show forth themselves in him. For Herod had laid hold on John, and bound him, and put him in prison for Herodias' sake, his brother Philip's wife. For John said unto him, it is not lawful for thee to have her. So here Herod wants to give some sort of explanation to the fame, the power, the mighty works of Jesus Christ here. And he applies it in his strange, Judaic, superstitious mind to be John the Baptist, for some reason, rising from the dead and showing his power in Jesus. Amazingly enough, it would be Jesus soon that would actually arise from the dead and give power to John the Baptists that would come afterwards, and mighty works would be shown in those that believed, but he had messed it all up. And nevertheless, he tries to explain away Christ's power by saying, oh, this is John the Baptist, and this is because I have crossed him in this way. The Bible records that Herod laid hold on John and bound him for the sake of his wife, Herodias, his brother, Philip's wife in particular. John had said, it's not lawful for thee to have her. Now, we talked earlier about Deuteronomy chapter 25, about the idea of raising up seed unto his brother. And had this been the case, John the Baptist wouldn't come to him. And as it says in verse 4, said, it is not lawful for thee to have her, Herod. So this wasn't a case where Philip had passed away and Herod was just doing the right thing according to God's commandments and taking care of Herodias the widow. No. Something else has taken place here, and what I believe has taken place is what it says in Leviticus chapter 18 and verse 16. Thou shalt not uncover the nakedness of thy brother's wife. It is thy brother's nakedness. Philip was alive and well. He had nevertheless lost his wife Herodias to Herod. Perhaps because Herod had rose to tetrarch and he was the boss, the head honcho, the grand poobah there in this place in Israel. And therefore, he was easily able to snatch up his brother's wife, or rather, maybe she left because of seeing and lusting after the power and the influence that her husband's brother had. And so she went to Herod. Whatever had taken place, it is really of no matter. John says, by the inspiration of the Holy Ghost here, it was not lawful for Herod to have her. In verse 5, and the first part of it, it says, and when he would have put him to death. Now, why would he put him to death? What has happened so far is that he had heard, Herod being, received, and enjoyed the preaching of John up until now. The Bible records that Herod loved to hear the preaching of John the Baptist. He enjoyed it. But what is happening now is the condemnation of John's words has fallen upon Herod himself. Now touching him personally, he's offended and affected by it. And now he wants to put John to death, put him away. But it says he feared the multitude. Now, Herod had the opportunity here to hear the word of God and repent, but instead, he decided to remove the prophet. And this happens to us all the time. We hear the word of God preached unto us, and we have the opportunity to repent at the preaching of the word and change and do right. But too often, some of us remove the prophet, shut up the Bible, turn off the preaching, stop going to church. Whatever it is that silences the mouth of the prophet is the first thing that we rush to in our rebellion. Herod here can just be an example of our own rebellious hearts. We hear the word preached, And we want the giver of that word to be put to death, as opposed to letting the word of God do what it's intended to do. Discern the thoughts and intents of the heart and actually get some good work done within us. So while Herod here at this point wanted John dead, he would have put him to death. Verse 5 continues, it says, he feared the multitude because they counted him a prophet. So here, Herod very clearly shows that he fears the multitude more than he fears the Lord. But also, he doesn't have the guts to go against the multitude and do what he would have done because he loves the power that he has over these. And he needs to, as a good little politician, maintain himself in their eyes and please them. This is a typical politician. We see it all the time. They will bend their motives. They will do the opposite of what they want to do just in order to appease the people. We're seeing this over and over and over again when it comes to the mandates that are going on. A politician will come out and say, we'll never lock down. And then the influence of the people steps in and says, oh, yes, you will. And they suddenly go, okay, yes, we will. And politicians come out and they make these great bold statements of what they would have done, but they fear the people. Again, this is another reason why we ought to, as Christians, fear God above all things. And then we can't be swayed by the influence of the people. We can't even be swayed by the influence of what we would have done. Because both things here would have been wrong for Herod. If he tries to appease the people by keeping John just locked up in prison for a time, he has done wrong. He has locked up the word of God in his life. If he destroys John, the same is true. The word of God is removed from his life. Either way, he's in sin. So it's clear he did not fear God. He ought to have, and then he would have been doing right. Continuing in verse 6, it says, but when Herod's birthday was kept, the daughter of Herodias danced before them and pleased Herod. Now, this is a bizarre scene, if I've ever seen one. A pleasing dance is put on by his wife that he stole from his brother's daughter, his niece. Comes and dances before him. And whatever that dance was, it pleased Herod to the point where he forgot that he feared the people. He forgot that he wanted to do a certain thing and would not afterwards. He completely relinquished any of his own thoughts and mind in this situation for the pleasure that came from Herodias' daughter, from his niece, when she danced before him. Verse 7, it says, whereupon he promised with an oath to give her whatsoever she would ask. And she, being before instructed of her mother, said, give me here John the Baptist's head in a charger. And so this bizarre scenario comes to pass where Herodias wants John in prison. Herod binds him. Wants to or would have put him to death, but he fears the people, and so he's caught in this back and forth scenario, wanting to please his wife at the same time wanting to please the people. Then Herodias, his niece's daughter, comes and danced before him, pleasing him to the point where he just completely loses his mind and says, whatever you want by an oath I will give to you. And all this was based on the instruction of the mother in the first place. It's a weird scenario. Nevertheless, the end result is exactly what Herodias wanted. So, and this is why I think Herodias actually left Philip to get the power of Herod, and now she is very clearly in charge here, even by manipulation and subversion, using her own children to get her will done in the kingdom. Verse 9, it says, and the king was sorry. Nevertheless, what a statement there. He was sorry, nevertheless. He was sorrowful for what he had done. Nevertheless, for the oath's sake, and them which sat with him at meat, he commanded it to be given her. How often do we have these times where we're sorry for something, nevertheless, we're going to do it anyways? I'm really sorry that I did that. Nevertheless, I'm going to do it again. That's the opposite of repentance. That's not even being sorry. That's not even being sorrowful. When we're sorry, there ought not be any nevertheless that follows it. I'm sorry nevertheless. That's his excuse that comes out. I'm just as guilty of this. I'm really sorry, but hey, my flesh is probably going to do it again. I'm really sorry, but yeah, I'll probably cross that path again one day soon. Real sorrow is linked to repentance, and it's a complete turn, a change of mind and heart that will lead somebody that's repentant and truly repentant in the right direction when it comes to facing their sins face to face. The sin comes, the king was sorry, and he ought to have acted upon that sorrow. What was that sorrow likely? Probably God smiting him in the heart, perhaps one last time. But it says, nevertheless, for his oath's sake, but not only the oath that he had made, and God does not encourage oaths. In fact, he says, swear not at all, neither by heaven or earth, things under the earth. Swear not at all. You cannot make one hair of your head white or gray. You cannot... You ought not swear by things that are outside of your control, because you'll find yourselves being ruined by those same swearings and those same oaths that you make. But it wasn't just for that. It also says, and them which sat with him at meat, he commanded it to be given her. So he had influence then of the people around him when this great dance went on. He couldn't make a decision for himself, though he was sorry, because he had made a dumb oath based on a fleshly decision, and because he was influenced and had respective persons among the people that were around him. And so, verse 10, he sent and beheaded John in the prison. Verse 11, and his head was brought in a charger and given to the damsel, and she brought it to her mother, and his disciples came and took up the body and buried it, and went and told Jesus. So all this was brought to our attention, seeing the end of John the Baptist, but what a life that was lived. You can keep your finger in Matthew 14. I'm going to go to John chapter 3 for a bit. John chapter 3. In the Bible recorded of John the Baptist that there was none greater born among women. That was Christ that said this. And here John finished his life the way he began his life, being a witness of Christ, being that forerunner of Christ. And he went before and proclaimed the truth. And Christ certainly is the way, the truth, and the life. It wasn't for the preaching and the doctrine that he went forth with. It wasn't for his discussions of the Old Testament law. It wasn't for the crying in the wilderness, repent. It wasn't for his gospel preaching that he was destroyed. It was because he had the gall to stand up to the government and say, what you're doing is not right. It is not lawful according to the word of God. And that's why he was destroyed. Herod, representing the government, loved his preaching. Repent and believe. He loved his preaching on the Old Testament. Whatever John would bring, Herod loved hearing it, but when it touched home, when it affected him and his wife, now things were suddenly different. And he was angry. He destroyed John the Baptist as a result of the preaching against him and what he was doing. In John chapter 3, we learn more about John in his last days, in the last moments that he was around. It says in verse 23, And John also was baptizing in Anon near unto Salem, because there was much water there. And they came and were baptized, for John was not yet cast into prison. So it's foretelling that John would soon be cast into prison. So God gives us that little clue, though if we had read Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, we'd obviously already have gotten that at this point. But he's highlighting that, showing John's freedom that he has now, showing the liberality he has in his ministry and what he's doing with his ministry at this time, when he is completely free to behave in his ministry the way he feels led of the Lord. It says in verse 25, then there arose a question between some of John's disciples and the Jews about purifying. So the Jews come to the disciples of John, who were directly under him and his teaching, and they want to talk about the purification. And I believe that probably had something to do with the baptism that was going on. Maybe they were saying, well, is this baptism washing away our sins? And that's why they are now calling themselves saved. That's why they are saying that they have eternal life or what have you. Maybe they're saying that the purifying of the flesh is what's bringing them salvation. Of course, that wasn't the case. And Peter talked about that. He says, not putting away the filth of the flesh, but the answer of a pure conscience before God. Though John's baptism was a little bit different, and we've talked about that before. But nevertheless, they're having this discussion back and forth. Verse 26, and it says, and they came unto John. So they can't obviously get it resolved among the disciples. So the Jews come to John, and John's disciples come to John, and they say, Rabbi, he that was with thee beyond Jordan, to whom thou bearest witness, behold, the same baptizeth, and all men come unto him. So I believe that what was happening, perhaps, was that the Jews, when bringing up the discussions of purifying, were also trying to cause some sort of schism between Jesus and John, to kind of pit them against each other. Look, this Jesus whom you said is now baptizing, and all the men that used to come to you are now going to him. And they're thinking that John was going to be upset by this. But John wasn't upset by this. Look at how he acted in verse 27. John answered and said, a man can receive nothing except it be given him from heaven. Ye yourselves bear me witness that I said, I am not the Christ, but that I am sent before him. So he says, I cannot receive the power to baptize, to minister, to lead you as disciples, or have anybody come and follow me except it were given from above. And you have heard me say that I am not the Christ, but I am sent before him. And who is I going before? That same him that baptizeth, and all men come unto him. Now, we did find clarity in the Bible that said Jesus wasn't baptizing, but rather his 12 disciples were at this time. Nevertheless, they're saying that his ministry, Christ's ministry, is the one that is getting all the attention. Verse 29. He that hath the bride is the bridegroom, but the friend of the bridegroom, which standeth and heareth him, rejoiceth greatly because of the bridegroom's voice. This my joy, therefore, is fulfilled. So he's saying, my joy comes from the fact that I'm standing as a friend to Jesus. I'm standing with Jesus. He's the bridegroom. He's going to get the bride. He's going to have all men come unto him. And all men will eventually become his bride in the last days. And my joy is fulfilled in the fact that I can stand with him. And I can point to him. And I can give him glory. And I can celebrate Christ in his day. And verse 30, if it wasn't clear already, just clarifies it. He must increase, but I must decrease. That should be a verse that is easily memorized and runs through our mind daily, moment by moment. Christ must increase, I must decrease. Christ must increase, I must decrease. He must increase, but I must decrease. And that was John the Baptist's ministry in a nutshell. If you were to just put John the Baptist, if they're in the name of naming churches and putting billboards up, and say John the Baptist, and their slogan would be, Christ must increase. That was his desire above all things. And he preaches on that in the next few verses. He that cometh from above is above all. He that is of the earth is earthly and speaketh of the earth. But he that cometh from heaven is above all. And what he hath seen and heard, that he testifieth, and no man receiveth his testimony. So he that is above all, that cometh from above, that is from heaven, and is certainly above, that must increase, comes and testifies, and no man is receiving his testimony. Verse 33, he that hath received his testimony hath set to his seal that God is true. You receive the testimony of Christ, that spirit of prophecy, your seal upon you is God is true. And when I was saved, that was basically what happened to me in that moment. I didn't know the ins and outs of the Christian faith. I didn't know the doctrines. I didn't know the main primary Baptist principles. First thing I did was, after reading the Bible, I marched into a United Church and tried to be servant unto a woman preacher, of all things. I didn't know much about Christian, but you know what? About the Christian faith, but you know what I knew? I knew God is true, and I was sealed by that truth. And God was able to use that. I received his testimony and set that to seal. God is true. And it says in verse 34, for he whom God hath sent speaketh the words of God. For God giveth not the Spirit by measure unto him. The Father loveth the Son and hath given all things into his hand. He that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life, and he that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. John comes out increasing Christ, lifting up Christ as what? The true Redeemer, speaking the word of God. Loved of the Father, who received all things into his hands, and through him and only him, power is given to receive everlasting life. He's above all. He's from heaven, and he is certainly above all. Nevertheless, he must increase, and I must decrease. And here John says this, and I wonder if he was thinking to himself, even unto my death. Even unto the very end, I desire that Christ would increase and I would decrease. Now we know Jesus said of John, he was more than a prophet. He was greatest born among women. He loved John. He respected John very much. And I believe that the reason for that is because John lifted him up so much in his life and in his ministry. He must increase, but I must decrease was the very heartbeat of John the Baptist. Go back to Matthew chapter 14. And even as that was the heartbeat of John the Baptist's ministry, and it caused a great love from Christ to go upon John the Baptist there. We have to have that same mentality. Lift up Christ. If I be lifted up, Christ said, I will draw all men unto me. Now, of course, that was talking about the cross. That can also be talking about just glorifying him in this world and letting his power be shown. Matthew chapter 14 and verse 13. Remember, they just came and told Jesus of what had just taken place. He said, when Jesus heard of it, he departed thence by ship into a desert place apart. So the first thing Jesus does is he hears of his good friend, his beloved John, as the groom hears of the friend of his that was now dead and gone onto heaven, onto glory, no longer in this world. He decides he's going to go find a desert place apart. Jesus often tried to find solitude, but it wasn't often before he started to have people hoard around him again. Here, John's gone. The full transition's taken place. Christ must increase, I must decrease. As far as an earthly ministry goes, it doesn't get much lower than death. He'd faced it, that first death. Would never again, or would never have to face the second death, certainly. But the ministry in this earth, the carnal ministry, was over with. His ministry as the forerunner that was prophesied long ago was done. He had finished his course. I don't believe any of this was a surprise to God, a shock to God. But here it concludes. And Christ, I believe, just kind of bows his head, hears of it, and says, all right, and goes into a desert place by ship. A deserted place, an alone place. Verse 13 continues, and when the people had heard thereof, they followed him on foot out of the cities. So Christ, trying to find some place to mourn and to meditate upon and to think about his good friend, suddenly finds people from every city on foot marching unto him. Jesus is sad, he's mourning, and nevertheless, he still has compassion on others. Verse 14, and Jesus went forth and saw a great multitude and was moved with compassion toward them, and he healed the sick. There's probably a time when Christ could have used some healing himself, even in his flesh, his stomach wrenching for the pain of a lost friend. And thinking about those things, you know, that he would no longer have that forerunner ministry before him. Thinking about the fact that that was the transition from being prophesied of and pointed forward and thrust forward to now the ministry and the candlestick was completely on Christ to go forward with, because John was no longer there as his partner in ministry. It says in Mark chapter, and you can turn to John chapter 6 if you would, but it says in Mark chapter 6 and verse 33, and this is the same context that we're dealing with from a different perspective. It says, and the people saw then departing, and many knew him, and ran afoot thither out of all the cities, and out went them, and came together unto him. So the people then, while Jesus sneaks off and tries to find a desert place, knew him. And what happened when they knew him? This is just an interesting nugget. Mark chapter 6:33. When they knew him, they came together unto him. That's a wonderful little truth there. If you kind of look at the parentheses that are contained there. They knew him. They ran thither out of all the cities and overwent him, and they came together unto him. When they knew Jesus, do you know Jesus today? What do? You got to come together and come to him. There's a good little nugget there that supports our gathering and our church assembly here. If you know Jesus, you come together and go to him. John chapter 6 then, I'm going to go to verse 1. Very long chapter here, but we'll just deal with the first part. John chapter 6 and verse 1, it says, after these things, Jesus went over the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias, and great multitude followed him because they saw his miracles, which he did on them that were diseased. So this is the same time frame, and I know that because I get the time stamp from the feeding of the 5,000, which is what we're about to talk about. Because they saw his miracles, it says. And also, Mark says, because they knew him, they recognized him, they desired him and what he had, because of that, they came unto him. Now, going to Jesus because of his miracles is not necessarily a bad thing. Christians ought to go to Jesus because they know his miracles. And when they need help in the time of need, they know that only God can pull them out of certain situations. So with the right motive, these people aren't wrong. They saw the miracles and they went to Christ. But I think some of these multitudes tend to have the wrong motive, didn't they, in going to him? And sometimes we tend to have the wrong motive in going to Christ. We go to him not with the intent of lifting him up and having him be glorified when he does a great miracle in our lives. We go to him because we just desire the miracle in our lives. Never mind what Christ is going to receive from it. He ought to receive glory in everything he does in our lives. So, because they saw the miracles here, it says, they went to Jesus. Now, this is going to play out. Watch in verse 3. It says, and when Jesus went up into a mountain, and there he sat with his disciples, and the Passover, a feast of the Jews, was nigh. So Jesus has this great compassion. He sees all these coming unto him, and though he's mourning, and though he's sad, and though he's perhaps holding back tears for his beloved friend, he nevertheless stays up in that mountain and begins to help others. Verse 5, it says, and when Jesus lift up his eyes, he saw a great company come unto him. He saith unto Philip, whence shall we buy bread that these may eat? And this he said to prove him, for he himself knew what he would do. I love when John reminds us of the fact that Jesus has all of these things in his knowledge. He knows what's going to happen anyways. Nevertheless, he proves his disciples from time to time. He's teaching them a lesson here, as he's been doing through the book of Matthew as we've been studying through it. Follow me. Here's a lesson. Philip answered, verse 7. Philip answered him, 200 penny worth of bread is not sufficient for them, that every one may take a little. So Peter here has it all worked out as approximately how much it would take to actually feed this group. So while the people come to Christ for the miracles, his disciples that had seen more miracles than any of them are now going to figure out how they're going to feed a big group of them with pennies. Penny worth is a day's labor, approximately. So if you break it down, there was 5,000 there, we'll see later. And 200 penny worth, he says, is not sufficient to feed them. He was figuring approximately $4 per person would take care of each. He did the math and he just simply said, well, this isn't practical nor feasible. We don't have this type of money to give $4 each to each one of these. That's not what Jesus was asking. Verse 8, it says, one of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, saith unto him, there is a lad here, which hath 5 barley loaves and 2 small fishes. What are they among so many? Again, just this rational, real-world solution to the problem. That is no solution. Why do they even offer this? Look, Jesus, we don't have enough money to feed them. Look, Jesus, we got a couple of fishes and some loaves that we borrowed from this boy. Certainly, though, that can't feed so many. So Peter brings in this boy's lunch, but then scoffs at the amount that is within it. Certainly that won't solve our need, now will it, Jesus? Verse 10, it says, and Jesus said, make the men sit down. Now there was much grass in the place, so the men sat down in number about 5,000. And Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed to the disciples, and the disciples to them that were sat down, and likewise of the fishes as much as they would. When they were filled, he said unto his disciples, gather up the fragments that remain, that nothing be lost. Therefore they gathered them together and filled 12 baskets with fragments of 5 barley loaves, which remained over and above unto them that had eaten. Then those men, when they had seen the miracle that Jesus did, said, this is of a truth that prophet that should come into the world. That prophet being specifically the one mentioned in Deuteronomy 18, that prophet being the one that God promised to Moses that the Lord would raise up, like unto you, Moses, but him the world shall hear. Before the miracle was done, the people knew Jesus. They knew the miracles. They knew where he went. They knew his face. They knew what he could provide for them. But it says here, after in particular, this miracle of feeding the 5,000, they went from just knowing Christ to knowing him as that prophet that should come into the world. And not only that, ready to hear them. That was the promise. And you can go back in Deuteronomy 18 when you have time, verse 15 to 19. Okay, it says there that they shall hear him. A prophet shall I raise up like unto you. Him shall ye hear. Hear Christ increased unto the people. Again, they just knew him. They came unto him. Now, though, they are ready to hear him according to that prophecy that went on beforehand. You can go back to Matthew chapter 14. Jesus intended to get a place apart. Instead, he fed 5,000 and became that prophet. This all happened after the ministry of John that was entirely based upon lifting up Christ and exalting him and having him increase. Certainly, as soon as John's ministry was happening, what do we see happening right away? Christ is increasing. Our application, let Christ increase in your life. Let him grow. Let him multiply. Let him do abundantly all that we can ask or think. Matthew chapter 14, then, look in verse 22. Matthew 14, verse 22. So basically what I skipped over in those few verses was exactly what was explained in John, the feeding of the 5,000. Verse 21, it says, and they that had eaten were about 5,000 men beside women and children. Verse 22. And straightway Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship and to go before him unto the other side while he sent the multitudes away. So here Jesus is going to try again. He sends his disciples across the way in a ship to the other side and is trying to now send the multitudes away. Verse 23 it says, and when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into a mountain apart to pray, and when the evening was come, he was there alone. So he finally got that opportunity. The disciples are gone, the multitudes are gone, and now Christ here is alone. Verse 24, it says, but the ship was now in the midst of the sea. So Christ is up on a mountain, there apart and praying. The ship now is in the midst, or in the middle of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. Now, this is always interesting to me, the prophetic language. The sea here, the disciples now seemingly are apart from Christ. And they certainly feel so once the sea starts being tempestuous round about them. The sea is likened unto the unbelieving multitude of people. Though they've been put away physically, here the sea is likened unto that. Where do I get that from? Revelation 17, verse 15 talks about the whore that sitteth on many waters. And when you saw the whore that sitteth on many waters, the Bible clearly says that these are peoples and multitudes and nations and tongues. That's what the sea represents in a prophetic language here. So disciples are being tossed about by a sea. But the sea isn't just moving of its own volition. The peoples, the multitudes, the nations and tongues, the world at large of unbelievers are not just moving about of their own volition. There is a wind there. As it says very clearly, the wind was contrary. Moving that into the spiritual realm, there's a mighty rushing wind is what the Holy Spirit is referred to as he enters in on that day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2. But there's also that idea of being carried about of every wind of doctrine. Here there's a contrary wind coming upon the people. Certainly there's that great wind of the Holy Spirit, Jesus breathing on his disciples and allowing for a great ministry to happen on their hearts, but there's also a contrary wind moving in this world, isn't there? There's a contrary doctrine. There's an every wind of doctrine that is ready to carry about the sea, ready to carry about the peoples, ready to carry about the multitudes and nations and tongues. And today, more than ever, we have a contrary wind, a contrary doctrine that is moving the people around God's people. The next example that we have, of course, is that safe haven, though tossed about, that they're in, the ship. I believe that's indicative of the church. They're in the church, being tossed about by the world as the wind, that contrary wind, drives and stirs up the world. For the moment here, it seems that the disciples are alone in the world, that they're led about, this world is led about that contrary spirit. Verse 25, they continue in their loneliness, it says, and in the fourth watch of the night. In the fourth watch of the night, in other words, they're not resting. There's at least somebody up watching. The fourth watch being around 3 to 6 a.m. This is the last moment before dawn arises. And it's amazing because even as the sun arises, so the Son of God arises to them at this time of the fourth watch. Verse 25, it says, Jesus went unto them walking on the sea. Jesus went unto them walking on the sea. And it's Christ here. He shows up seemingly just when they needed him most. That 11th hour, the final moment before the next day, the fourth watch, when things are at the grimmest, when people are tired, when they just don't think they'll make it through the night, there's Christ. Here he gathers, finds the gathered disciples, even as he finds the gathering church today. They're assembled, they're in the ship, and even though they're being tossed about by the world, they're in it, but not of it, right? They're not wet. They're not under the water. They're not in the water. They're certainly in the church, in the world, but not of the world. They're tossed about now, but not overcome. And here Christ comes to them in their time of great trouble. And I love that because the church as a whole, we're in the same place. When we gather together, we're unstoppable. We're protected. We're cared for. But that certainly does not eliminate the fact that we could be tossed about by the world. We could be pushed by the world. We could be blown by the world. And we could be attacked by the world in the same way that these waves are contrary unto that ship. Now, as often is the case, it says that the disciples did not recognize him at first. Verse 26, when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, "It is a spirit!" And they cried out for fear. And in the same way, sometimes we don't recognize Christ for who he is. When we're going through hardships, that hardship could be Christ's influence on us. Sufferings and loss could be Christ's influence upon us. Pressures and temptations could be going on around us in those same trials there to grow us as a church and grow us as individuals. Instead of saying, "Is this Christ working in my life?" we're always like, "This is some demonic spirit. This is some other spirit, contrary, pressing on us, coming our way. We're about to be destroyed." And here they cried out for fear. It's a spirit. It's some other troublous spirit. It's some other contrary spirit. What in the world? We're going to be destroyed by this thing. I'm so afraid. Verse 27, but straightway Jesus spake. And here, as he often does, when the world is in turmoil, being pushed about with every wind of doctrine, and it's causing the church to sway to and fro and be in fear of what the world has, of the influence that the world has upon them, here Christ just simply walks in and speaks unto them, saying, "Be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid." Our great comfort as believers ought to come from Jesus' spoken word. And that's what we have here in our King James Bible. Jesus speaks the word into our lives, and that ought to bring us good cheer. That it ought to remove us from the realm of fear. Be not afraid, Christ said, straightway as soon as fear came upon them. And they started to think that their scenario was another spirit rather than the Spirit of God. Verse 28 says, and Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it be thou, bid me come unto thee on the water. So here, as I've been saying, like the Bereans, Peter received the word. Be of good cheer. It is, I, be not afraid. But now he's received the word with the readiness of mind, and he's now going to search the scripture. He's going to search the word out. He's going to ask back at the word and see if these things are really so. Lord, if it's you. Lord, if you're revealing this to me. Lord, if this is truth, I need you to bid me come. I need you to give me another word that affirms what I'm seeing here today. Prove it's you, God. Prove it's truth. Prove it's true. He received the word, and now he's searching to see if it's so. Lord, is it thee? And Jesus replies, come. Verse 29, he said, come. When Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. Come out of the church. Come into the world. Come. Be not of this world, but above it. Come, trusting me. Jesus says, affirming everything that Peter had heard. What did he hear? Be of good cheer. It is I. Be not afraid. And what is Jesus saying when he says, come? Step out of your comfort zone. Trust me. Come into the world and the influence that it may have on you, but be above it. Come out in the power that I give you to walk on water and to go to Jesus. And Peter does so. Verse 30. But when he saw the wind boisterous, in other words, when he saw that contrary wind, when he saw that contrary spirit, when he saw the same spirit, the same wind that was manipulating and moving the world around about him, he was afraid. This is a good thing to take heed there. We'll learn from Peter, right? We can learn from other people's mistakes. Here, Peter saw that contrary wind. And that contrary wind today is coming from your news media. That contrary wind today is coming from the false teachers of this world. That contrary spirit today, unfortunately, and I've been watching it, is coming from Baptist pulpits all around us. Here, that contrary spirit. When Peter saw it, that boisterous wind, he was afraid. We need to learn not to be afraid of that contrary spirit. We need to learn not to be afraid of that spirit, but to continue on in the command and the promise that God has given us. And what was his promise? Come. And when Peter acted upon that promise of Jesus, he walked on water. When Peter acted upon the promise of Jesus to come, he wasn't afraid. He was of good cheer, and he went to Jesus. Going to Jesus produces more coming to Jesus and more coming to Jesus. You become closer. You can't get close enough to God, Almighty God. But here he got afraid. And beginning to sink, verse 30, he cried, saying, Lord, save me. Thankful for the promise that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That's not just a good gospel presentation verse. That's a good gospel living verse. Call upon the name of the Lord and you shall be saved. And that's exactly what Peter showed here. Lord, save me. Not his eternal soul. Not so that he could go to heaven now believing on Christ. No, he said, save me from the water I'm sinking in. Save me from the contrary and tempestuous and boisterous wind that's sweeping this world around me, these waves around me. He's afraid. And when he became afraid, he broke the command that Jesus had just made. Be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid. That's encouragement and that's also command there. Be not afraid. And God says to you today, be not afraid, both an encouragement and a command. To be afraid now of anything other than having the fear of God is sin. Remember that, Christian. He knew enough, though, when he became afraid, He called upon the name of the Lord, as the psalmist said, "What time I am afraid, I will trust in thee. I can't do this. Lord, help me." The Bible records in verse 31, and immediately, I love that, immediately, Lord, save me, and immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him and said unto him, "O thou little of faith, wherefore didst thou doubt?" Now, people love to pick on Peter here, but let me just draw your attention to the fact that Peter's the only one that stepped out of the ship, right? Peter's the only one that had enough guts to not only receive the speech from Christ, but to search it out and to say, "Hey, is it you, Lord? And if it's you, let me work for you. Let me do something for you. Let me get closer to you. Let me follow after you. Let me walk on water." And he did. And he certainly walked long enough that he was within an arm's reach of the Savior before he doubted and sank. So here, when I see Christ say, "O thou little of faith, wherefore didst thou doubt?" I don't read it like I used to, where it's, "Oh, thou little of faith, wherefore didst thou doubt?" Christ was proud of Peter in this moment, I believe. I believe he was excited that Peter stood up above the other disciples and said, "Lord, bid me to come. Lord, I want to walk with you. I want to walk to you. I want to be with you. I spent all this time out in the middle of the sea. Look what it's gotten me. Yes, I'm in the church. Yes, I'm with your believers, but I'm afraid, Lord. The world is swarming around me and moving me and carrying me about and punching the ship and pushing the church whithersoever it wills. The wind, this contrary doctrine, this contrary spirit is causing it to be so. I've spent my time in that, and Lord, I want to be with you. Bid me come unto the end of the water." And he does, and he goes. And immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand and says, "Oh, thou little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt?" Peter, you almost did it, friend. Come on, man. Good job. Like, way to go. "Oh, thou little of faith, wherefore didst thou doubt?" You were this close, I believe, is what he's saying. It's the same spirit that I have when my son is trying to shoot a basket and he gets a foot away from it because it's like this tall, right? So he throws this thing up and I say, I don't go, "Wherefore did you fail?" and come down on him. I said, you did it. You tried. You were close. Don't doubt yourself. You can do this, right? Next time. Don't give Peter a hard time. He stepped out by faith. He asked after Christ. He stepped out and he called out. And these are all good things that we need to learn. Ask after God. Pray unto him. Go unto God, seek after him. Call out to him when you get to the point where you can't get any further. Good principles for the Christian life there. A whole sermon probably. Brother Jamie will preach that one later. Not a rebuke. I think this was encouragement to the church. Verse 32, "And when they were come into the ship, the wind ceased." So when Christ got into the ship, taking Peter with him, that faithful disciple that stepped out on the water, suddenly the wind ceased. Suddenly the waves stopped rushing. Suddenly, once they were in the ship, in the church, with Christ, it's almost like even if the wind were rushing, they wouldn't know it nor care. It's almost like if the waves were pushing and swaying, they wouldn't know any better, because they were now with Christ and he had increased unto them. Look what it says in verse 33. "Then they that were in the ship came and worshipped him, saying, Of a truth, thou art the Son of God." This is like that statement that's made in 1 John 5:13. "Whosoever believeth, these things are written unto ye that believe on the same name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God." These believed he was the Son of God. These believed that he was the Christ, the Savior of the world. They'd confessed it previous. They were following him because of the leadings of John the Baptist, pointing, he must increase. He must increase. He must. This is he. This is the Lamb that was slain from the foundation of the world. He must increase. Follow his ministry. John never got offended when people stopped following John and started following Jesus. That's exactly what he wanted. That was his whole purpose. Then the multitude comes to him, a great group of people, and they come to Christ and they see that he is who he says he is. They know his face. They know his miracles. But once he does that feeding of the 5,000, it really impacts them, and he goes from being Christ to being that prophet. He goes from being Jesus who heals people to being that prophet that not only does he heal, but he also must be heard. And now here to the disciples, they get on a ship, they go across, they spend a little bit of time seemingly away from their Savior. And in that place where they were gathered together, in the church, in that ship, in the wilderness, in the great sea, they're tossed about by a contrary spirit, influencing the world around them to cause them to stumble and to fall and to move with every wind that would affect them personally. The world certainly getting a hold of it, but them in the church were safe, though not out of the reach of the influence. Here they see Jesus come. They're worried it's that same other spirit that's affecting him. But one disciple stands up and says, Christ, is that you? Jesus, is that you? And he says, come. Peter goes, steps out, and immediately, the moment he doubts, he falls, calls upon the name of the Lord. Jesus picks him up, encourages him, and then brings him into the ship, and immediately there's calm. They're in the church. They're all gathered together, Christ with them. They're on the sea. Certainly, they're in the world, but not of the world, because they're separated from the walls of the ship, the hull of the ship. The sea now is not being tossed about with the wind. If it were, they wouldn't know it, because they're now together. And when they get together with Christ in the midst, first thing that happens, they're in the ship. They came. They worshiped him, saying, of a truth, thou art the Son of God. They believed that already, but now it's like they really believe it. Christ had just made himself real unto them. Christ had just increased. And look, this increase is not something that Christ wants to be alone in, because he was happy to bid Peter to come and to join him. As Christ increases, he wants to pull us up with him, and I believe that very much. But he must increase, and that needs to be our desire. And look what happened in the life of John the Baptist. John said, he must increase, he must increase, he must increase. And when John finished his course, finished his ministry, when it was all said and done, and he breathed his last breath, Jesus says, there was none greater. He was humble. And as a result, John was exalted. How do you get exalted? Be humble and lift up Christ. How do you be cared for in this life? Be humble and lift up Christ. How do you realize your ministry to the fullest? And we all have one. Be humble, lift up Christ. This is what we're learning here. Follow me, increasing. On to bigger and better things. Pressing on that upward way, new heights we're gaining every day. Pressing on to higher ground. It's what Christ calls us to do. I love the pictures here. I love how Christ uses these scenarios to reveal to the people he's dealing with who he really is. And that's the high, lofty, exalted Son of God, the Savior of the world. That prophet that was prophesied so many years ago. We need to be ready to know Christ and hear Christ. And therefore, as he increases, we increase. We need to be ready to be faithful in little in order that we could be faithful in much. Believe on him, of course, we've all done that. But also be faithful and trust him to do according to his word and to his will. And in doing so, and in lifting up and exalting Christ, worshiping him, the Bible says here, you'll come to that truth that they did. It's going to be a moment, I think, for all of us. It's going to click. Of a truth, thou art the Son of God. I believe some of us had those moments in our lives already where it's like, I can't get another step in. It's the fourth watch. I'm tired. I'm exhausted. It's the 11th hour. There's no hope. then Christ shows up. You may doubt for a moment, but then eventually you come unto him, and he's waiting there to immediately stretch forth his hand and catch you up, and he solves your problem. He solves your hurt. He solves your hardship and enters your life with a great and wonderful miracle. Maybe you're not walking on water, but it feels like it, doesn't it? In that moment when you say to yourself, and pray to him, of a truth, thou art the Son of God. What a great and wonderful thing you've done in my life. Man, I want to have those moments every day where I just, wow, wow, you are the Son of God. That's amazing. I believed it, but now I really believe it. I believed in the name of the Son of God, but now I believe on the name of the Son of God. He must increase. There it is. He must increase. I must decrease. And the wonderful side effect of letting Christ increase in your life is he'll bring you up with him. Glory to God. Thank you, Father, for your word. I pray, God, you continue to help us as we walk through these scriptures. Continue to work in our lives that we would follow you, Lord, and glorify you in every way as possible. We love your word. We love your spirit that guides us into all truth, that calls these things to our remembrance. Something like he must increase and I must decrease. I pray, God, your spirit would push that into the hearts of these people here today, throughout this week, over and over and over and over. He must increase, I must decrease. Help us to be humble and lift you up and be exalted as a result. The end goal simply being that you would be exalted. We love you. We thank you for your word. I pray, God, for those that couldn't be here today, Lord. I pray, God, for those that would be here, that will believe on your name. As you said in the scriptures, there are some out there that are waiting to believe on you, waiting to get in this ship. I love you, Lord. We all love you, and we're thankful for everything you do. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Since I said it, I'll grab the hymn, Higher Ground. And we'll sing a few verses of that. Higher Ground. 327. Stand when you find it. 327. That was quick. That's interesting. Verse 3, I want to live above the world, just like that ship, just above the world. Just like Peter walking on water. They're just above the world. It's amazing. Now let's sing verse 1, verse 3, and verse 4. I'm pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I'm onward bound, Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's tableland, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to live above the world, though Satan's darts at me are hurled. For faith hath caught that joyful sound, the song of saints on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to scale the utmost height and catch a gleam of glory bright, but still I'll pray till heaven I've found. Lord, lead me on to higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Amen. We're dismissed.